به برنامه نان گل سرخ خوش اومدید. سلام به همگی، من مریم نمازیم.
من فریبرز پویا هستم.
در برنامه این هفته در رابطه با انفجار معدن یورت صحبت خواهیم کرد و واقعا وضعیت فجیح کارگران در ایران.
مصاحبه این هفته با فوزی الیاس از آتیستای پاکستان.
فتوای احمقانمون در رابطه با اینه که دانشگاه ها باید مثل مسجد بشن.
لازم ندارم دانشگاه، هیچ کشوری دانشگاه میخواد،
مسجد کافیه. و لحظه زیبای زندگی در رابطه با راهپیمایی زنان در کویت در همبستگی با زنان عربستان سعودی علیه قوانین سرپرستی مرد بر زن. با ما باشید، جایی نرید. متاسفانه با خبر شدیم که اخیراً در معدن یورت در گلستان یه انفجاری صورت گرفته، تعداد خیلی زیادی جونشون از دست دادن. واقعاً تسلیت میگیم به خانواده این عزیزان و همبستگی خودمون رو واقعاً دوست داریم که این عزیزان گرامی بداریم اینجا. و یعنی یه واقعیت که نگاه میکنیم به شرایط این کارگران معدن، میبینیم که این یک نمونه از واقعا وضعیت فجیح کارگران در ایران
و محیط کار در ایران. عدم وجود امنیت، این اتفاق فجیح در واقع یک لحظه شد که جامعه ایران و جامعه دنیا ببینه که واقعا هیچ امنیت کاری وجود نداره. کارگرها برای چندین هفته اعتراض میکردن و مدت زیادی که بوی گازهای مسموم میاد مثل متین. روز قبلش بازرس اونجا بوده و در واقع معدن زغال سنگ رو نبسته به خاطر وضعیت خطرناکش و روز بعد چنین اتفاقی افتاده. این نشون میده که نه تنها این معدن، خیلی از معادن و تمام محیط کار، اکثر محیط‌های کار تحت جمهوری اسلامی در ناامنه و هر روز ما شاهد این هستیم که کارگرا و مردم زحمتکشان تو جامعه توی ایران زندگیشون رو از دست میدن به خاطر اینکه بتونن خانواده‌شون رو سیر کنن.
و خب میدونیم که حتی در این شرایط واقعا سختی که کارگرای معدن دارن کار میکنن، میبینیم که خیلی‌هاشون حقوقشون رو نگرفته بودن، خواستشون این بود که حقوق موفقه‌شون رو داده بشه. و آدم واقعا باور نکردنیه که کسی بره سر کار و برای ماها حقوقشو نگیره و به خصوص کار به این سنگینی و سختی و خطرناکی. واقعا یک فجیعه. و در ضمن میدونیم که این یه واقعیت برای خیلی از کارگرای توی ایران. خیلی از اعتراضا حول پرداخت نشدن حقوقای موفقه است.
دقیقا اول ماه مه اعتراضایی که توی ایران بود، یکی از خواستای اصلی پرداخت حقوقای موفقه است. و اینکه حالا حقوقی که یک سوم زیر خط فقر هست که اکثر کارگران و مردم کارکن تو ایران دارن دریافت میکنن، همون هم بهشون نمیدن برای ماهای خیلی زیاد. یعنی واقعا وضعیت شرم‌آور و فجیح زندگی اکثریت جامعه ایران نشون میده که تحت حکومت اسلامی چه دنیای سیاه رو حاکم کردن.
بعد هر وقتم فعالین کارگر میان اعتراض میکنن، خواست بر حق خودشون رو درخواست میکنن، میخوان به دست بگیرن، میبینیم که اذیت و آزار میشن، سرکوب میشن. میبینیم که فعالین کارگری، رهبران کارگری رو زندانی میکنن،
مهر امنیتی میزنن تا کسی میخواد اعتراض بکنه. میگن که شما بر علیه امنیت و امنیت مملکت و نظام جمهوری اسلامی فعالیت کردین. چه امنیتی؟ گرفتن حقوق عقب افتاده امنیتیه، خواست افزایش دستمزد امنیتیه. و واقعا نشون میده که تحت حکومت اسلام و جمهوری اسلامی پایه‌ای‌ترین حقوق انسان زیر پا گذاشته میشه. و این اتفاقی رو که توی معدن زغال سنگ یورت اتفاق افتاد نشون داد وضعیت کارگران و زندگی کارگر و کارگران رو در جمهوری اسلامی. و اهمیت داره که در رابطه با همبستگی صحبت کرد.
دقیقاً. و به خصوص مهمه که همبستگی خودمونو با فعالین کارگری، با رهبران کارگری که توی زندانن رو نشون بدیم، فشار بذاریم روی جمهوری اسلامی. خبر خوب اینه که بهنام ابراهیم زاده بعد از 7 سال زندانی آزاد شده و 1 سال بیش از اونی که قرار بود نگرش داشتن و خب ولی کسای دیگه هم هستن که تو زندانن، مثل عبدی از کانون معلمین
دقیقا.
که واقعا لازمه که همبستگی خودمون نشون داد و در ضمن همبستگی خودمون رو با خواسته های واقعا برحق کارگران، من جمله دریافت دستمزد موقت، افزایش حقوق پایه‌ای، چی میگن،
حداقل دستمزد
و حق تشکل، حق سازمان دادن،
بتونن بتونن اعتراض بکنن، بتونن حرف بزنن، بتونن نفس بکشن برای زنده موندن. در واقع وضعیت کارگرها تو ایران اینه که برای زنده موندن دارن تلاش میکنن، برای بهبود زندگی، و هیچ کس نباید زندگی ایران رو به امنیتی و تحت شکنجه و زندان و تعقیب قرار بگیره. خیلی از رهبرای کارگری الان تحت تعقیب هستن به اشکال مختلف توی پروسه های قانونی.
واقعیت اینه که واقعا فعالین و رهبران کارگری دارن برای همه جامعه و همه مردم ایران میجنگن و اینکه همه کار میکنن، همه به حق و حقوق حداقلی احتیاج دارن، همه حق دارن که توی امنیت بتونن کار کنن بدون اینکه خطر داشته باشه. مثلا یه روز برن سر کار، جسدشون بره زیر، میدونین، از بین برن. یعنی اینا واقعا جنگ برای یه جامعه ایران و مردم ایران، و به همین دلیل همه بخشای جامعه باید از حق و حقوق کارگران دفاع کنن.
Fozia Elias, it's a great pleasure to have you on our program. I wanted to speak to you about your own experiences, why you left Islam.
Basically, I belong to a very religious family. If I see on my background, then my father and my mother, they are very, very religious. And I was also very religious before my marriage. When I was 15, it was really forcedly marriage by my father. And after my first marriage, I get to know that there is nothing real. I mean, only fairy tales. And we are really forced to do the things. We are not concerned those things. We have to pray for 5 times a day. And I was asked by my father, even by my husband, that I have to cover my head. I am not allowed to come in front of any stranger. Even I was not allowed to talk to my own friends. I mean, my life was really stuck and stopped after my marriage. It was such a bad experience for me because I never thought about it. I have many thoughts in my mind that I will do this and I will achieve something in my life. But after my marriage, I experienced it. It was really worse for me. I was really forced and I was really tortured by my husband. And he really beated me over not covering my head. He always told me, don't speak with strange person, don't come in front of my cousins as well, and don't talk to your friends. And before marriage, I was told to by my father and my friends, because I was really a school-going girl when I was married, and I was told that marriage is such a nice thing, very beautiful thing, and I will get a lot of new dresses, jewelry, and shoes. But it was not like this. And my friends, they used to say that you can have your own house after marriage, but it was nothing like that. I mean, I had such a bad experience with this. So I asked many times to Allah, that why my husband is beating me with no reason, why he is torturing me by every day. So I just changed my mind and I thought, and there was no answer, Maryam. I asked Allah very, very times, you know, every night I cry and I ask him for help, but there was no solution. if there is really Allah, then why he was not listening to me? Why he was giving more and more power to my husband and he was beating to me with no reason? So then I decided, I thought, no, it is only mistake of my mind. Actually, there is no Allah, no supreme power. How can a supreme power allow to a person to beat a woman or anyone with no reason? So that's why I just left Islam.
Some people will say you just had a bad husband. It's got nothing to do with Allah or Islam. What would you say to that?
Yes, he was also like this. I admit that he has no respect for women, and I don't know what is his history and what is his background. I really don't know. I don't know. But Maryam, this is such a common sense. If you are really a nice human being, you can have learned something about humanity and you know your basic rights. You can treat others equally. It has nothing to do with Islam or it has nothing to do with any religion. This is common sense. So he must have to treat not only me, but others also. So yes, I must say that there is nothing to do with religion and nothing to do with all Islam and other things. So this is the, this is the Islam who give powers to man to beat woman, because it is written in Quran that man is superior than woman and woman is really inferior and you can beat your wives. I mean, how can a supreme power could give a power to the man? We are also human being, women are also human being, but they have no respect for us.
What happened when you decided to leave Islam? What happened to you?
It was such a big step for me in my life. I had suffered a lot in my life. At that time, when I got married, I was 15 years old. At the age of 17, I had a child, the baby girl. She's not with me. But yes, after declaring that I don't believe anymore on Islam, I paid a lot. I mean, I was rejected by my family. They disowned me. I asked my father many times to help me regarding this issue, which was going on in between me and my husband. But he always said, no, this is your personal matter. Once you are married, you are married. And you have nothing to do with us now. Your husband is your master. Just do whatever he wants to do. Yeah? And just go and obey him. What happened to me, actually, my father, my whole family, they disowned me. And I also had to flee my country because now I'm living in Holland. And the really bad thing to me is I had to leave my daughter. I mean, I was forced to leave her because my ex-husband, he had custody. And he got custody from court of my daughter because court said, if you are not Muslim and if you, the mother is not really religious, how can she brought up her children in a way? So, I mean, this is the big loss of my life.
How many years have you not seen your daughter?
I remember before 4 days, it was 27th March, and it was her 9th birthday. So from last 5 years, I didn't see her. I have no contact with her, and I am even not allowed to talk to her, to see her. I cannot. So from when she was 4 years old, then it was really last time when I have seen her, and I just talked to her. Now, no.
That's, as you say, the greatest price you've had to pay. But you carry on. How do you find the strength to carry on?
Look, Maryam, what I want, what I have suffered, what I have paid, I don't want any woman, especially the woman from Pakistan, because I know what is going on in Pakistan with our women, with my women. They are my people. So they are suffering every day. I don't want to let these things happen with them, with those women. So this is the reason, this is the strength, this is the courage I get every day. I talk to myself every day and I assured myself every day that no, I have to speak up, I have to stand up, not only for me but for my people, my women, because they are also suffering, and I know it very well because I belong to that land, that is my country, and I understand what is gonna happen and what is happening still now and what is the current situation. So this gives me really courage and power to stand up and to speak up for the people who are suffering.
Why did you start Atheist Agnostic Alliance of Pakistan?
I started it in 2012. It was really a first organization for atheists. Actually, what I seen that when I had questions in my mind, there was no one to whom I can ask. I can share my thoughts, what is going on in my mind. So then I thought there must be any platform for Pakistani atheist people, because I knew that time also that there must be people who think like me, the like-minded people. So I thought there must be some platform. I googled it and I searched it many times, but I didn't find. So I thought there must be a platform, so I started with the help of Sayed, my husband. So we both decided we will start a platform. It was really dangerous for us because in Islamic country you cannot do these kind of things. But we did it.
This is with your second husband. And tell us now about blasphemy laws in Pakistan. You're campaigning on behalf of several people, including Ayaz Nizami. Tell us about the laws, its impact, and what's happening with IS?
In Pakistan, Pakistan is a Islamic country. I already told many times on several platforms that 98% population is Muslim in Pakistan. It is really easy to accuse anyone in blasphemy law. When someone is not agree with you, not agree with your thought, or with your point of view, you can accuse them in blasphemy law. I mean, you cannot ask any question over religion. If you have something in your mind that why Allah has written these things in the Quran, you cannot dare to ask questions. You cannot raise questions over Islam. So this is what is happening in Pakistan when people, because now most of the people, I know the majority of Pakistani people, they are atheist now. They started to asking questions. But when they ask to someone, they accuse them in blasphemy law. And they say, no, you are kafir. Why you are asking it? This is what Allah has said. And He said everything really perfectly. And He has expressed everything really perfectly in the Quran. So this is what many people are in Pakistan, they are accusing them in blasphemy law. Someone if write anything, I mean, if not speak by spoken, but if they write anything on Facebook, they just book them in blasphemy law. Most of the people are suffering in this way. Their lives are on stake. People are running from their for their lives. They are running to save them. Their families are also in trouble. But no one cares. They only want to save Islam, but they have no care and no responsibility for the human beings. I mean, there is always a question in my mind, if Allah has promised to preserve or to care or to protect the Islam, then why Islam is always in danger? But I never found this question. I mean, always Islam is in danger. What I have seen in Islamic and Muslim countries, this is really funny, that Islam is always in danger. But even they believe, Muslims believe, Islamists believe that Allah has taken this responsibility to preserve, to save Islam. Then why they are fighting, they are killing over people with no reason, they are killing innocent people, they are accusing them in blasphemy law. And what happens in blasphemy law, no one will accept your case. No lawyer will come to you, nobody will ask you, because they think, and this is true, because in most of the cases, the lawyer are also killed by Islamists. No court accept your case because judges also think about their lives. So this is really dangerous.
So tell us about Ayaz Nizami and what can be done about his case. What is his case?
Ayaz Nizami is basically a religious scholar. And he is also a vice president of our organization, AAAP. But yes, he has taken by the authorities, FIA Pakistan, only because he was writing some contents. But they say this is blasphemous content, but I don't believe, because I always see him that he always asks question. He raises question over religion. And he search, he read most of the books of Ahadith and Tafsir also. And he raised question and he asked why it is like this. I mean, why Allah has written this and why the other Islamists and Muftis and why they have ulama, they have written it. And when people, they have no answer, the people who protect these things, when they have no answer, they just accused him in blasphemy law. So this is what, I mean, he's such a religious scholar. And now he's just suffering. He's arrested by the authorities of Pakistan. This is really terrible.
And what about Facebook's role? I mean, we hear that Facebook, the government has asked Facebook to help it remove blasphemous content.
You know, Facebook has removed almost 85% content. They say blasphemous content from Facebook. They also have suspended my page. Atheist and Agnostic Alliance Pakistan, they also have done IHE youth page and CEMB page as well. So they are removing. I mean, Facebook is totally working for Pakistani authorities. Even Facebook says, no, this is the platform for express yourself and just you can come here, you can write your thoughts, you can express yourself. But it is not like this. Facebook is totally working for Pakistan. They are helping them. So that's really disgusting, I mean.
What do you think people can do to help Ayaz and free thinkers and, you know, atheists in Pakistan?
What I found, Mariam, after arresting of Junaid Hafiz, Asia Bibi, and now Ayaz Nizami, our people are really afraid. They are afraid even they have changed their names from Facebook. They have hired, already they have... They were, yes, leading the fake accounts, but now they are really afraid. And you can think about it that it is really dangerous when someone can come in front of media or anyone, anyone authorities and can say that, yes, I am in the favor of Ayaz Nizami, so it can be also dangerous for them. But now people are hiding, because they are really worried for their own lives. So what I want the international organizations for human rights, who are working, the CMB, IHEU, and others also, CFI, I want to ask them that please stand up with us, because our people are really afraid to talk about it. Most of the people are also threatening me in my account, Facebook account, and they are sending me messages, don't do this and you will be killed and whatever. But you know, if everyone will be silenced, then how can we say, how can we convey our message to the world, and how can we preserve our own human rights? So I want to ask for the help all organizations to put pressure on Pakistan, because now I know this matter only can be solved by putting pressure on Pakistan, and without it, it is not gonna possible. I know, because Junaid Hafiz is suffering in prison from so many years, and as well as Asia Bibi. But I don't want Ayaz Nizami suffered a lot in the name of Islam, because we have already paid a lot in the shape of my life, you know, my daughter, in the shape of Asia Bibi, and in the shape of Junaid Hafiz, but no more. Yes.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Mariam.
علم الهدا نماینده خامنه ای که انقدر
اون بالا نشسته، کسی جرئت نداره چیزی بهش بگه، اون نباید چیزی بگه.
مثلا ایشون گفتن که انقدر میدونین، انقدر واقعا حرفای طلا از دهن این نمایندگان میاد بیرون که واقعا آدم نمیدونه کدومو انتخاب کنه. ولی این دفعه ایشون گفتن که
صحبت کرده قیمت طلا افتاده پایین.
ایشون گفتن که دانشگاه باید مثل مساجد بشن و خب مشخصه، خب به نفع اوناست دانشگاه مثل مسجد بشن، یعنی که فکر نکن، انتقاد نکن، چیزی جدید یاد نگیر، فقط به حرفای یه مشت آخوند عقب مونده اطاعت کن به حرفاشون. خب معلومه که
دانشگاه مرکز سکولاریسم و آتئیسم و انتقاد این برنامه هست، اینا زیاد خوششون نمیاد.
خب نیست،
راست میگی، آخه این چه جایی درست کردن؟ جوان ها میرن چیزای خوب یاد میگیرن، حرف میزنن، فکر میکنن، دنیا رو میخوان پیشرفت کنن، احتیاج ندارن، میتونن از این گیوه های آخوندی بکنن، پاشون تو خیابون را بیتونن، لباسشون رو عوض کنن و به آیت الله سپریچوال لیدر خیلی بزرگ بشن. اینا فکر نمیکنم ولی مشکلشون حل بشه. فکر میکنی مشکلشون حل میشه با اینطوری؟ فکر نمیکنم. احمقانه.
در کویت خانومی به اسم هادیل بورقیس، ایشون یک راهپیمایی رو سازمان دادن به اسم با ایشون را میرم، یعنی با زنان را میرم، و این یک راهپیمایی بود در دفاع از زنان عربستان سعودی که دارن علیه قوانین سرپرستی مردان میجنگن.
لحظه زیبایی همبستگی بین زنان در به خصوص در کشورهایی که اسلام حکومت داره و قوانین ارتجایی اسلام زندگی زنان رو سیاه کرده و مسئله سرپرستی مردان و قوانین سرپرستی مرد با زن یکی از مرتجع‌ترین قوانینیه که در جوامع اسلامی حاکمه.
و همین الان ما میدونیم یک خانم جوونی به اسم دینا علی که سعی کرده از عربستان سعودی فرار کنه، در فیلیپینس تقاضای پناهندگی کرده و خانوادهش اومدن و با زور ایشونو برگردوندن به عربستان سعودی به خاطر همین قوانین مردسالاری و قوانین سرپرستی مرد که وجود داره، و امیدواریم که دینا علی امنه الان در عربستان سعودیه. و خب این راهپیمایی واقعا معنی واقعا زیادی داره، اهمیت بالایی داره برای زنان عربستان سعودی و به قول شما زنانی که تحت حاکمیت اسلام زندگی میکنن.
این ما رو میاره به پایان برنامه این هفتمون، تا هفته آینده از طرف ون و
مریم، روزا و شبای خیلی خوبی داشته باشین.
Goodbye.
Mariam Namazi.
And I'm Faribos Puya.
We're hosting a program called Bread and Roses. It's a weekly program that's broadcast in Persian and English in the Middle East and North Africa, primarily Iran as well. And it's also shown on YouTube internationally.
And we've been doing this since last May. We're coming up to our year's anniversary. And we've had quite a lot of fun making these videos.
We discuss taboo-breaking, free-thinking ideas. The Islamic regime of Iran has called us immoral and corrupt.
And that's why you need to support us. We are and the alternative voice in Middle East and North Africa.
Of corruption and immorality. So do support us. Here's a short video from Patreon that explains how you can help us with even just $1 a week. That's nothing. Support us.
Patreon lets fans become patrons of their favorite artists and content creators. It's different than Kickstarter because it's not about one big project that requires lots of funding. It's more for bloggers or YouTubers or webcomics, anyone who creates on a regular basis. Here's how it works. When you become a patron, you're agreeing to give an artist a tip of an amount you set every time they release a piece of content, whether it's a new song, a video, or a recipe. You can set a monthly maximum to make sure that you're always within your budget. Choose an amount, enter your payment information, and you're done. Becoming a patron allows you to view and post in the artist's stream, and in exchange for your support, artists offer additional patron packages, which might include monthly Google Hangouts, music production tutorials, pre-sale concert tickets, or anything they can offer as a way to say thanks. Patreon, empowering a new generation of content creators.